It's a Monday night in 1968. Students and hippies file into the Family Dog, an auditorium that's hosted landmark musical acts like Bo Diddley, Muddy Waters, The Doors, Buffalo Springfield. It's a long list despite only lasting a couple years. Tonight, however, like every Monday night at the Family Dog, is Monday Night Class. Stephen Gaskin started his Monday night class as an English teacher at San Francisco State College. As San Francisco's Haight-Ashbury began to flood with young thinkers fleeing west to America's new counterculture, Stephen Gaskin moved his open discussion group from a classroom to a stadium, hosting weekly meetings attended by as many as 1,500 people at a time. In 1970, Stephen Gaskin led a caravan of 60 buses around America on a speaking tour before settling in Tennessee, where he and 300 spiritual seekers founded The Farm. Members of The Farm would revoke all material possessions, take vows of poverty, and reject the use of alcohol, tobacco, and animal products. After a 20-year FBI investigation, a deposal of Stephen Gaskin, and over 50 years of adaptation to a changing world, The Farm still stands today. We had the chance to talk to G, a third-generation member born on The Farm, whose real name and location we've kept anonymous for her safety and privacy. She shares her truth about growing up on the farm and the difficulty of leaving her sheltered life. This is Aging Everywhere.
I'm G. I'm 27 years old. I was born on, I think technically it's called an intentional community or a commune in the middle of Tennessee, in the middle of nowhere. It's definitely outside of what America is. The police don't really come onto the land. Government workers, they don't really come on. It's kind of the same rules as a Native reservation. And I think it's actually sanctioned legally as a church. It started with a bunch of hippies in the 60s in California, around like the Bay Area, Stanford. They followed one particular leader, Stephen Gaskin. It's anti-government, pacifism, socialism, all the things it means to be, I guess, a super, super intense hippie. There were thousands that would go to Monday class, listening to his teachings through meditation, through your relationship with the universe, and specifically your connection to the world when you take LSD, psilocybin, and cannabis. They decided that they did not like what was going on in the outside government, the wars happening and a lot of changes going on in the world. So they packed up their whole lives in school buses. Everyone bought a school bus and they caravaned from California all the way to Tennessee across the United States in these school buses. And they landed in Tennessee. It's like caught on camera of Stephen saying, well, this is where the vibes felt best. Really, I think it came down to the land was like dirt cheap. They got a bunch of land there and they started the farm community. One of the main values of the farm is sustainability. They're really environmentalist. They want to be able to grow their own food, not rely on the government for food or groceries or actually any supplies. They're growing weed in California, obviously, but they chose to be in Tennessee. They started growing weed like as immediately there, and the locals, like the hillbilly Tennessean locals, these people are terrorists. Called the feds on them immediately. Immediately called the feds. There's a whole raid. Stephen Gaskin went to jail. Weed got banned very early on, like on the farm. Nobody could grow weed on the farm. They still needed a place to find weed because marijuana was a really big part of their spirituality. So the pioneers that they were, some of them stayed up in California in Humboldt, and that's where they grew all the pot. We on the farm, they grew soybeans, and in Humboldt they grew weed, and we traded soy for weed and across the country. There's something in Tennessee called ragweed. It's just a garden weed. It grows like crazy, but the stalks are really big. It looks a lot like marijuana. And that was growing all over the farm. And so the FBI created like this entire like campaign to take the farm down. Like, they did not like a whole little government being there. Like, they infiltrated the farm. They sent like moles in to pretend like they were hippies to join and become a member, and launched full-ass FBI investigations. farms. Ended up coming in and raiding the farm for like a week straight, like top to bottom, turning everything top to bottom. They didn't find one single thing. It was completely clean, and the government had put so much time, money, and effort into this infiltration that after that, they basically couldn't touch the farm ever again. I'm actually the first third generation baby ever born on the farm. Well, my grandma wasn't born there, but she's the first generation, and then my mom was born there, and then I was the first baby to be born, which that's because my mom had me at 15. So I was like the first baby, everybody raised me, all these 15 year olds came together and raised me. But my grandma was a huge part of raising me as well. They lived in the farm basically when it was, it's a bad like connotation that comes with the word of communism, but that's what it was. When you entered the farm, you signed a vow of poverty and you relinquished everything that you owned to the farm. You grew all your own food, so everything was in bartering and trading systems, and everybody had a job. You know, there was midwives and nurses, there was people who grew the food, and there's even like, you know, a mechanic who fixed the cars, and everybody had their job, and it was like a very delicate ecosystem that worked for a while, but it didn't work forever because one of the things that the farm banned, and this was a lot of Stephen Gaskin's rules that he like had, they banned anything chemical, anything from the outside world, which is interesting because they didn't ban like LSD. Like LSD and all those kind of things was okay. However, pharmaceuticals and birth control was not. So birth control was not allowed, and they had a lot of babies. When there's a lot of babies, there's a lot of mouths to feed, and there's a lot of women taking care of the babies rather than working. The highest population, I think it was like 1,500 people on the farm. People were hungry and they were cold. It was no outside help from the government. I mean, you see it a lot in Native reservations as well. Stephen Gaskin ended up getting thrown out of power, and rather than communism, they changed to a democracy. There's a board, voting, group decisions. Everyone went and got jobs off the farm. There's like businesses on the farm, but people also can go off the farm and make their, everyone has their own money, their own bank accounts, their own houses. You don't own your house, but you have to pay to build it. Being a child there, so I had a very interesting upbringing. It was a juxtaposition between city and country because the farm obviously is a lot of country. We didn't really have internet, cell phones, like that kind of thing. But my mom, she chose to leave the commune when I was two. She was only 17 at the time, and she went to New York City. So I split my time between New York City and the commune. It is tough at sometimes feeling different than everyone, but I'm my mother's child, first and foremost, and she moved to New York City in the Lower East Side of Manhattan, off the farm, to have a freaking awesome life. Like, we traveled and we did all the stuff, and so when we weren't on the farm, we were in the city. Like, she was like bartending in the clubs. Mind you, I was a child adapting to both. My mother, she was already 15, 16, 17, 18 at this time. She had to adjust from actually being born on the farm, raised there. She went to high school on the farm. Like, not to mention it was a completely vegan community, so we tried meat for the first time together. We tried, you know, candy for the first time together in the city. I remember my first sip of soda. It was crazy. Like, I was bouncing off the walls. Like, I had never had anything like that. No processed food, nothing like that. My mom, me, my aunt, we didn't really talk about it. You know, we pretended like the farm wasn't a part of us for a really long time because it's hard to explain. No one really like understands. And my aunt, she still lives in New York City, and she runs like a Marriott, like a JW Marriott Essex House, and down by Central Park, and beautiful, amazing New York City lifestyle. But like, it's hard to talk about the farm to people because how do you really explain it to the depth that you would want to people to see that it's a good place? We just like chose not to live there anymore, you know?